slipped under fences, climbed out of windows, take to the wind, whichever way the wind blows.
As the producer of a Grammy-nominated album, Carole King's A Holiday Carol, singer, songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, and recording artist, Louise Goffin is a badass, multi-talented, modern-day Renaissance woman.
Yeah.
Woo! After our own heart. Woo! That's the kind of women we love. Oh. Born in the 60s in Brooklyn, New York, and raised in California's famed Laurel Canyon. Oh, you got stories. We know you have stories. In the part of the most exciting times in popular music, her childhood was spent absorbing influences of the period that has shaped what we know as music today. Her formative years gave her a virtual PhD in popular music in the making of as the firstborn daughter. Daughter? Our generation's most renowned songwriters. Carole King, Jerry Goffin. Yeah. Oh my God, really? Okay. With her 2004 release, Songs from the Mind, which, by the way, is available in the lobby.
2014.
Oh yeah, last year. Anyway, I have to tell you, I have been listening to this. Oh my God. At first listen, it was like, oh, this is really nice. Second listen, I really like this. By the third listen, I'm singing along. I am so loving this CD. You're going to love this CD. Okay, you have to get it. Okay. Music writer John Canis wrote, Louise is at a high point of Goffin's musical career, professional career. So far, Goffin produced her latest record and played piano, B3, ukulele, and guitar, adding a touch of snare drum and tambourine. One man, one woman band. Love that shit. Louise's debut public performance was opening for Jackson Brown. Wow. At the Troubadour when she was 17, and I just read the article that tells that story. You have to tell us about that too. She has played with other known musicians as a side woman. She appears playing banjo with Brian Ferry.
Oh.
In his video, I Put a Spell on You. She went on to play guitar and tour with Tears for Fears in 1997. That's crazy. With a lifetime spent soaking up the finest music for a generation and a love of songs that has put you in a movie that put you in a movie lyrically? I don't understand what that means. Louise employs, I should read this first. Louise employs a rich palette to fashion songs from the mind. Radio DJ Jim Nelson of KSCN Radio calls it.
KCSN.
Thank you. I need assistance. I'm like the host that's like, speech impaired. I need some cheesecake. Pure nirvana for pop melody freaks. And Kenneth writes, with such an inspired work to offer in 2014, one can be forgiven for hoping Louise Goffin doesn't make us wait another 6 years for the next one. We won't be waiting another minute for this one. Ladies and gents and children of no ages, please welcome. It is my honor, my thrill, to welcome Louise Goffin.
Well, that was an amazing introduction. I don't know how to follow that up, except I owe you a story about Johnny Depp and Jackson Brown.
Yes. Yeah.
And Brian Ferry.
But I'm and I'm going to sing you a song first. So I'm the daughter.
You're the daughter.
I'm from Brooklyn.
Yeah.
I think everyone in this room will be able to relate to this song. If you have someone in your life that you want to get off their tweet, get off their, anyway, here it goes. This one's called Main Street Parade. Smile and wave.
instead of in your eyes. It's not complicated. See, I don't need a big production.
Successful record producer who's produced Kiss and The Wall by Pink Floyd and Peter Gabriel's solo records, and it's the list is endless. And he's also, you know, just a great guy. And I met him in England. I lived in England 10 years. I went there in 1984. I got a little record deal, and I knew not one person, except I had a friend who had moved to New York, and she gave me a phone book. And she says, here's everyone I know in England.
Wow.
And that's how I went to London. I just said, went through her phone book and said, I'm a friend of, and that's how I made my friends. But it worked out okay, actually. I never saw her for 25 years. I hung out with all her friends. Anyway, during that time, a girlfriend of mine who was a single mom, percussion player, who played with The Who, and David Gilmour, her name's Jody Lynn Scott, she goes, I just can't keep helping but think that David Gilmour would love your music. I have to introduce you to. So finally she did, and I took this train and I went out to this big, like, you know, farmhouse, and basically he was so shy, we hardly talked. I mean, he just, you know, was in there showing me that. Anyway, and then we kind of met, and then years later, I had heard he really loved this song I put out called Bridge of Sighs, which is on a record I put out in 1988 called This Is the Place. That was kind of a VH1 hit. I had big hair in it. Anyway, long story short, I met Bob Ezrin at David Gilmour's house once, and I didn't see him for like 20 years. And I was working in the Village Recording Studio. I saw him once when I was producing my mother. And he listened, and he was like, this is an amazing record. And then I didn't see him again. And I walk in to record one of the songs on my album, Songs from the Mind. And I see Bob Ezrin's name in the parking lot. I go, oh, I'm going to say hi to Bob. And when I try to security in the village goes, nobody is going back there. No one. But I know, Bob. Nobody goes back there. And someone said, there's a big movie star back there. No one can go there. So I figured out, okay, someone leaked. It was Johnny Depp who was in the studio with Bob. And I just went, okay, I got my own work to do. Never mind. Very last day, Wednesday. Friday is when it all happened. But Wednesday, I left my keys. I go back into the main place to get my keys. And Bob's at reception. He goes, Wheezy! Hey, you want to come back and meet the boys? And I go, sure. And I come back and he goes, like, here's Johnny. Johnny's wearing his guitar down here. And he's smoking a vapor cigarette, so he's covered in vapor. So I see Johnny in vape, you know, looking buff and cool. And his guitar's down there and the whole band's. And then he's like, how you doing? And he introduces me to Alice. He gives me the best intro ever, saying, which is true. His introduction, which I'll now tell you, which is a true story, is when I was 17, I got a record deal, and my first producer choice was Bob Ezrin, and I went to his house, and he says, I am not going to produce you. I am not going to be the person to ruin your life. And called the record company and said, I won't produce her on the basis that her going in the music, she's a sweet girl and it's going to ruin her life. Aww. And now he jokes, he goes, yeah. That was a good strategy. So that's how I was introduced to Johnny Depp, and Alice was a sweetheart. And then 2 days later, I'm thinking they're busy men. 2 days later, I walk in the studio on Friday morning, and the reception says, Bob says, don't leave today without going in and saying hello. So I go upstairs, and I say, I'm doing vocals, I email, I'll come down, and then he walks in. And he says, all right, let me hear. And I go, oh, I'm playing the track, I'm doing it all myself. And he says, I think you should speed this up. And I go, really? I sent the guitar back to SIR, and he said, no, I think you should. Just indulge me for a minute. You don't have to listen to me. I don't know anything, but. And he wanted to really speed up and turn it to like a dance track. Huh. And I said, Bob, I have to recut everything. He said, what do you need? You need guitars? We got guitars. You need drums? We got drums. You need rock stars? We got rock stars. And then he left. It was 4:15 on a Friday, and they usually leave at 6, and I usually like leave at 7. And I looked at my engineer, and I said, did he just say what I thought he just said? I'm pretty sure he just said rock stars. And I went, I can't not take him up. He just offered me Alice Cooper and Johnny Depp and Bruce Whitkins and Tommy Hendrickson to sing on. Okay, all right, give me that guitar. So we set it up, I recut the guitars, and I went down. Well, first I had to borrow a guitar. And then I went down, I said, okay, Bob, I'm ready for the rock stars. And he goes, well, I'm working on the drums. You gotta go ask Alice, it's his session. So Alice is lying on a couch like this. You know, the two guys are by the coffee machine, and Johnny's in the control. And here's a really good phrase that served me well. If I can get, would you be willing to out, the next request is easier. Instead of like, I really need you, I was like, would you be willing to do some really simple hand claps and backing vocals on my session upstairs? I say to Alice Cooper. And he's like lying like this, and he's like, yeah, sure. I was like, really? And then because I don't read Rolling Stone magazine, which is sitting on that table with Johnny Depp on the cover, I said the thing that embarrassed me the most. I said to Johnny's best friend, I said, does Johnny sing? And he said, I don't know. Why don't you go ask him? So I go up to Johnny and I said, do you sing? And he's so cool and so like grounded. He goes, I'm all right. So I said, they're going to come upstairs and sing with me. Would you be willing to come? He goes, yeah, sure. And then Bob's working on the drums. And I walk through Village Recording Studios with these four Hollywood vampires, like black, you know, tattooed on little me. And the Village staff is just like going, what is happening? Like they're all. And then I go into a little tiny control room with two sets of headphones, not enough for everyone. And, you know, one person's going, all right, here's a beat. And I go downstairs to the receptionist and I go, get up here with an iPhone right now. And I give it to the camera and say, take pictures, take videos, take. Which I have, and, you know, I plastered them on Facebook on that Friday. And then on Monday morning, I got a call saying, could you please take And I've been scared to like put any of them up since. So anyway, that's lesson in people say, well, wait, did you have a lot of trepidation? And I was like, I have no time for trepidation. You know, sometimes you just have to know, I need to act now if this opportunity is going to happen. And you could not have put that session together. You know, you'd be through lawyers and God knows getting all those people in the room. So it was fun. All right, I've told that story. Now I'm going to tell a story about what happens when you make some foolish decisions. It's called Deep Dark Night of the Soul. Am I allowed to swear on the computer? Oh, no. Right, you can be taken off for profanity. This is my other youth song. Building sand castles right beside the shore. Then a big wave crashing over, a kingdom was no more. I was eating ice cream, three scoops on my spoon. Summertime in June. You think I would learn back then, falling down the rabbit hole. In the end, everything works out. Deep dark night of the soul. J'aime déteste pas dans le sable. J'aime mon temps promenade avec mon chien Fifi et mon chat Coco. J'aime le roman nouveau. J'aime beaucoup les petits cigarettes. No more living in straw houses, dizzy on the wonder wheel. I'm a badass bitch with my shit together, make my bridges out of steel. Yeah. You think I would have learned back then, falling down the rabbit hole. In the end, everything works out. Deep dark night of the soul. Trombone solo. Basic ingredients of life is a piano. And so many venues say, no, we don't have the piano. So I've learned to write songs on other instruments, thank God. The ukulele is my favorite one because I don't have to do a lot of writing. I just feel so cool with my little U case and throw it in. Anyway, Vicki, thank you so much for reaching out. And
And I do have, we had a piano in New York, and we just sold the apartment and sold the piano.
Oh, no, that's okay. And I have a weighted keyboard, but it breaks my back, so
yeah.
Just have a light. I have a few other tunes I could do here. I think I'll do one of my, one from my new record. Actually, those two are all are on songs from the mine, which, was a really satisfying journey making that record. It's my favorite record I've made, and I do love other records I've made, but this was the first one I produced myself. And it came from doing a lot of, here's what it came from, and I think it's applicable to women who write. I was a mother raising toddlers, writing songs with a husband who was going to this recording studio we both owned and making records that earned money while I was taking care of the kids, which I wanted to do. That was like I was very child-centered, going to the art room and loved all that. But my recording started to like take 6 years. And then, you know, what happened it about... not even 2 years ago, I'd say it was about October of 2012, I went, you know, if anyone asked me to play any of my songs, I wouldn't know how to play it. Mm. I have lots of songs, and they're all in my iTunes library, and they're all on my hard drive, and I'd play the demo I made in my studio. And I thought, my songs, they're not in my body. They're actually off somewhere, and I don't even own them, I don't even know how they go. And I went, I'm going to change all that. And so I went to Hotel Cafe and I said, I want to do a residency. I want to play every month and I'm going to feature a different artist every month. And they said, well, just you can do one and let's see how it goes. And I got a bunch of friends and I did meet one musician who I've worked a lot with since. And that started a whole journey for me. First of all, I was terrified. And from that point for the next year, I played 18 shows everywhere. I went from having a band to having a duo to playing on my own, and I wanted to feel like wherever I went, I could take something out of my pocket. I could even pick up a harmonica and I could play a show for you. And I wasn't dependent on anybody for me to sing my songs because I knew how my songs went. And that's how my record started. By the time I made the record, the work was done. Every song on the record has an ending. There are no fades.
Yeah.
There are no fades because I performed those songs and I ended them. And it was a really fast birth, that record, because I had the music in my body. I wasn't looking at a producer or the band to save me. It's like I knew how it went. Boom. Went to tape. So I hope you will get a chance to enjoy that. And this is one of the songs I wrote with Liz Rose in Nashville, and it's called Follow My Heart. Slip down the fences, climb out of windows, take to the wind whichever way the wind blows, but I always follow my heart. Turned on the sprinklers, picked all the roses, made an escape just before some door closed, but I always follow my heart. One ran from the best, but I've got the scars and the tears and tear in my dress, cause I always follow my heart. I have days when I look up in the sky, there's not a cloud in sight. I have nights when I scold myself and hold myself and say that it's alright, cause I always follow my heart. I've been down some roads I thought love lived on. I got there and then gone. When I'm lost, I listen for my own song. That's when I know where to start. I always follow my heart. Fences, climbed out of windows, take to the wind whichever way the wind blows, but I always follow my heart. I've been down some roads I thought love lived on. I got there and then gone. When The Jackson Brown story, I'll say very briefly. I was 17. I started living on my own earlier than a lot of people, because my mother moved to Idaho when I had 1 year of high school left, and I said, I am not. I am not. She actually moved where there was no running water, no electricity, and I was 17, like ready to finish high school and start my life, and I was like, I'm not. I don't know. And she says, well, you're old enough to take care of yourself, you know. So I stayed. I was not old enough to take care of myself. I lived in this little house on stilts. I decided to adopt 3 white kittens, which was a poor choice. Persephone, Blanca, and I can't remember the one. Anyway, there were 3 cats constantly running around. And I drove myself to high school. And I had a boyfriend, and I lived in a house on stilts, which was a great metaphor for exactly where I was. Anyway, I had met Jackson Brown maybe a year earlier, because I guess he lived near, we had a summer Malibu rental 1 year before, and we met then, and he had my number, and he called me up, and he asked me to open for him at the Troubadour. And I said, no. And my boyfriend was sitting next to me at the time. He said, what was that? I said, it was Jackson Brown. He just asked me to open for him. And I'm not ready. I'm like, really not ready. I haven't made my record yet. I don't know how to play my songs. I'm too scared. And he looked at me. He said, call him back right now and say yes. And I said, really? I don't think I can play. And I was so shy. You had to come up this close to hear me sing. I could dig in the piano and I could play, Jojo was a man who thought he was a woman. But you couldn't hear me sing. I was very, very shy singer for many years, maybe at least another 10. And I called him back and I said, well, I think I'll do it. And that was my first gig. And I almost didn't take it. So that's my story, and I'm going to play you a song that's really beautiful. I know I've been playing up-tempo songs, but I did produce my mother, as Vicki said, and it was a real honor to do that, to make this holiday record, which is a beautiful record called A Holiday Carol. And it works every year. Every year, if you don't have it, you can still get it, because it's a timeless record. And it was an interesting relationship with my mother, because I'd never had that role with her where I was her producer. I actually felt like I was my dad a little bit. It was like, Carol, get on the mic. Do I have to be on? Can't the band do it and I'll sing later? No, you have to be on the mic. All right, you know. Anyway, we were really a good team. You know, our personalities are really different, but we worked really well together. And everywhere we went, people said, you guys, you really have a nice thing going with the way you're working on this record. And I knew enough to know that she was great. So every time she tried to slip out of things, I'd reel her back in and go, no, you're playing piano on this song, you know, because she kept wanting to, like, go back to Idaho and hide. Anyway, we needed a New Year's song, and there was no New Year's song. There's maybe 3 that we found, and they were all wrong, and so I had been gestating a New Year's lyric for most of the record. I didn't really know what it was, but then I went to England, and I wrote with one of my old friends there when I used to live there, named Guy Chambers, who's produced a lot of records. And I walked into a studio and we wrote this tune, and it's on her record. It's called New Year's Day. Everybody makes a dream this time of year. From now on, it's gonna be good for you. All your friends and family around in peace and harmony. It's a time to remember your blessings. It's a time to remember
should all friends be forgot? Keep everything they gave you. And though they may seem so far away, you walk with them each and every day. And I know sometimes the road isn't easy, and we've said some things wish we'd never said. Once a few times you've loved and lost, you pick yourself up and take a chance again. It could be the time of your life. Everything's gonna work out alright. It'll be okay in every way, making it better. It's New Year's Day.
It sounds like it's like.